blood of the Lord has shed me. He has cut me from all evil. With my to some other place. Of Jacob, Joseph, being 17 years old, was feeding the flock with his brethren, and the lad was with the sons of Bilhah and of the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives. And Joseph brought to his father their evil report. Now Israel loved Joseph more than all his children, because He was the son of his old age, and he made him a coat of many colors, a robe. And when his brethren saw that their father loved him more than all his brethren, they hated him, they despised him, and could not speak peaceably to him. And could not speak peaceably to him. Let's read verse 11 through 20, and you'll catch me at verse 20. And his brethren envied him, but his father observed the same. I need you to really hear that. And his brethren envied him, but his father observed the same. And his brethren went to feed their father's flock in Shechem. And Israel said to Joseph, "Do not your brethren feed the flock in Shechem. Come, and I will send you to them." And he said to him, "Here am I." And he said to him, "Go, I pray you, see whether it be well with your brethren and well with the flocks, and bring me word again." So he sent him out of the vale of Hebron, and he came to Shechem. And a certain man found him, verse 15 says, and behold, he was wandering in the field. And the man asked him, saying, "What seek you?" And he said, "I seek my brethren. Tell me, I pray you, where they feed their flocks." And the man said, "They are departed from here, for I heard them say, 'Let us go to Dothan.'" And Joseph went after his brethren and found them in Dothan. And when they saw him afar off, even before he came near to them, they conspired against him to slay him. And they said one to another, "Behold, this dreamer comes." Let's read verse 20 together. Let's read. "Come now, therefore, and let us slay him and cast him into some pit. And we will say, 'Some evil beast has devoured him,' and we shall see what will become of his dream." And we shall see what shall become of his dreams. Ladies and gentlemen, before we go to subject matter, I want you to understand that there are people in your life like Joseph's brothers. I want to see what become of your dreams, your rich testimonies, how good you keep saying God. I want to see what comes out of you since you've been going to church all these years. You sing in the choir, you musician, you have a position. I want to see what comes of your dreams. I want to see what comes about your faith, how well you speak of God. I want to see what happens to your dreams. But I want to talk to you today from the thought God is getting you palace ready. God is getting you palace ready, kingdom ready, ready for kingdom business. Amen. So please tell somebody, God is getting you palace ready. Palace ready, palace ready. You can have your seat in the presence of the Lord. Palace, kingdom. Palace, kingdom. Kingdom, palace. The truth of the matter is, the kingdom is already here. So he's getting you kingdom ready, not ready for the kingdom. But the kingdom's already here. The power's already here. Joseph, I want to dig right in this quickly. Joseph is 17 years old when he is noticed. The Bible says that his father loved him more than the other brethren because he was the son of his old age. And he made him a coat of many colors. They did not like the fact that it seemed like he favored him over them. Those of us that have children clearly know that there's not or supposed to be a favorite. All of your children are different.
And they came at different times. But you love them all the same. Could it be that when the one that's walking in obedience get more than the one that's walking in disobedience, they think you favor them? Obedience brings blessing. Disobedience brings curses. So it could be that I don't necessarily favor him, but because he's walking in obedience, the blessings are falling on him. And when the blessings are falling on him, it looks like he's favored. But in reality, watch this, he's not being favored. It's the blessings that's favoring him. And that's what makes him look like he's being favored. But without the blessings on him, he would not look like he's favored. You need to understand the blessings favor you. The blessings give you favor. You don't give favor to the blessing. Don't miss that. I said the blessing gives you favor. You don't give favor to the blessing. And so when you are blessed, you are favored of God. And folk will get jealous of your favor, but your favor is an extension of your blessings. And I can't help the fact that I've been blessed by God, and that the favor of God is on me because the blessings of God are overtaking me. That's not me being favored. That's me being blessed. And it just so happens my favor comes with my blessings. God help me to preach here. So he's 17 years old. And the Bible says that his father sends the brothers out to feed. What was amazing to me is that the father would send his 17-year-old boy to go find out what the brethren were doing. Prior to that, he brought back an evil report. So what the father understood is I can trust him. Y'all ain't saying nothing. Y'all know the saying, what is it? Snitches deserve stitches. Here it is. His father can trust him because he wasn't snitching. He was just telling the truth. Oh, they won't talk here. God, and you got to understand something about the truth. The Bible says, and they shall know the truth, and the truth shall make them free. So in other words, what Joseph really was doing, he was trying to free them from what they were doing because he understands the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. So when we bring things to light, we have a tendency to believe they're telling on me. They don't like me. No, I'm trying to make you free because the more I enlighten you that what you are doing or what you are saying or where you are going is all wrong places. And I don't care what anybody in the world ever tell you. The more you sin, the closer you get to death. So Joseph really wants to free them. At 17 years old, he wants to free them. He brings back this evil report. Evil report says that they were doing something that went against the grain of God and went against the obedience of his father's house. So he brought back, now I can trust you that you'll give me the truth no matter what happens and no matter who's involved, you will give me truth. And every time you give me truth, somebody's going to be made free. God help me here. And so the Bible says that because he went to look for his brothers in Shechem, he did not find them there. And he was wandering around and a stranger took notice of him. Anytime God is prepared to move you, people will take notice of you. Some of the strangest people in the world will walk up to you and say, I see the glory. There's something different about you because you carry something that I have not seen in a long time. It's not necessarily that people know you come to you and tell you about the glory of God. It is the people that don't know you and you walk by them and they say there's something different about you because God will allow people that don't know you to know you so they can know him. And the moment you say the glory of the Lord is on my life, now they want to investigate about this God that brings glory to your life. That's why the Bible said we're overcome by one another's testimonies. And so deal with this, the fact that this 17-year-old boy, he is out there in Shechem looking for his brother, and a stranger comes by and see him wandering and ask him, who are you looking for? He says, I am looking for my brother. And here's what the stranger said. I heard them say, I heard them say that they were going to Dothan. Now Joseph goes to Dothan to find out. And the moment they see him, watch how the enemy is. The moment somebody sees you and they know that God's anointed is on your life and that you're favored by God, they say, here come that Christian again. Here come that preacher again. But what they don't realize, if I can get a hold of you and you can get a word out of my mouth, I might be your blessing that God sent me to you. First thing is this. You know how it is when you get saved and you're good and saved and the folk in your family not saved and you come around and they say, here come that preacher again. They're going to preach them at this time, or they came to give me another word. What they don't understand about that is you have got to understand that when you're in my presence, and because I'm in the presence of God, you stand in a place that you might get blessed, healed, delivered, and made free. You ought to be glad I'm coming, because when I come, I'm bringing anointing. I'm bringing deliverance. I'm bringing power. I'm bringing authority. I'm bringing fire with me. So when I step in the room, you will be glad I fell in the room, because he's with me every step of the way. Touch him on the shoulder and tell him, if God is with you, I don't mind being in your presence. If God is with you, I don't mind being in your presence. And I must tell you this, ladies and gentlemen, there must be evidence that God is with you. So the Bible says that he says, here, the moment they set eyes on him, Brother Lawrence, they didn't talk to him. They didn't even know why he was coming. He could have been coming to give them relief or bring them food, but they automatically condemned his coming. And they said, here comes that dreamer again. Now let me take you back when Joseph dreamed. When Joseph dreamed, he dreamed a dream, and he said to his brother that the Lord showed me that you all will pay obeisance unto me. They got upset and said, you mean to tell me that we're going to bow before you? But that was not what he said. He said, you're going to pay obeisance unto me. In other words, you're going to honor who I am from where God is getting ready to take me. And you have no idea, when God takes me where God is going to take me, it will come back around again. You better be careful about tearing down bridges that brought you over, because you might have to go back over that bridge again. People taking care of you and you have attitudes. You don't understand. If I take care of you, I'm making a bridge for you. I'm putting a roof over your head, and you have the audacity to walk in my house with an 18 out of 12. The devil is a liar. Tell somebody, you better appreciate the blessings that are next to you. You better appreciate the blessings that are around you with your unappreciated self. You need to appreciate the people God put in your circle, the people that God calls to pray for you, the people God let that laying on their face at night, smack out their nose and cry and calling your name out. And you've got the nerve to come up in here like you, oh God, help me preach like I feel it. So, I'm almost done. So, here comes that dreamer again. What shall we do to him? Because I'm tired of him dreaming. First he told us that we was going to pay out the insurance. Then he had to never tell our daddy that he going to pay out. But watch what verse 11 said. Verse 11 said, but his daddy observed the same. Oh, help me. I don't care what he heard. He observed. See, there was something about when God speaks. I don't care what you do. God put a mark on his word. And you can never forget the thing that God said to you. No wonder the Bible says you got to forget those things that are behind you and start reaching to the things that are before you. Press toward the mark. The reason why a lot of people are failing and falling and dying, Brother Field, is because they're living in the past and their future. felt something there. They're living in their past, which is here, but they're living it in their future, which is here. So if they're living their past in here, their future is in their past. Watch this. So here is my past, but here is my future. But I keep living in my past and my future. So my future started to look like my past. I almost did the moonwalk, didn't I? My future is starting to look like my past. Y'all ain't gonna say nothing here. You need to tell your neighbor, forget about your past. It's time to move forward, because your past is your past. What's behind me is behind me. What's in front of me is greater than what's behind me. I left that foolishness back.
What me and First Lady did, me and First Lady made a pact. No matter what kind of situation we get in, we can't talk about the past.
Stuff
is dangerous. It might take us into the past. Well, baby, I remember when you, all right, then I got some stuff to remember too, then, if you want to walk that road. Let's go down memory lane, if we would. I got about 3 things to remember about you, since you want to remember all this stuff. And before you know it, we're trying to grow, but we keep just stepping back in our past, going down memory lane. Baby, you start to forget some of the stuff that's behind you. I wish I had. Oh, God, I got a word for everybody here. Tell your neighbor, get over it. And the reason why you got to get over it, because you discover it's not helping you get better. A matter of fact, it's making you worse. So you need to understand, I need to get over it. I need to get past it, because I need to move on. I've got better days in front of me. I'm not crying about you no more. I'm not sitting here worrying about you causing migraines and headaches. I'm moving on. I'm getting ready for college.
Yes.
All right. Y'all sit down, please. Tell somebody, God is getting you ready for the palace. Palace ready, palace ready. Kingdom ready. Palace on church stuff. Kingdom ready. Palace ready. Ready to walk in the anointing. Ready to walk in God's favor. I'm tired of lip service. I need somebody going to serve God from their heart, that can lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. That can speak things that are not as they are. That can speak life into their situation. God, I wish I could preach to somebody here that won't come. Your kingdom business. Hallelujah. I'm sorry, but I'm tired of church. I'm sorry. I want to deal with kingdom people. Church people got too many problems. They complain all the time. Too many situations. They don't like what you wear. They don't like what kind of hat you got. They don't like what suit you wear. They don't like the type of clothes you wear. If you don't sit in the right seat, they don't like you. If you don't high five them, they ain't saying nothing. And after church, they leave and don't speak to nobody. Oh, God, I'm tired of church folk. I need to talk to somebody that's punishment. Some people don't like you. You got an attitude because they don't like you. I'm not here for you to like me. I'm here because Jesus is in love with me. I'm not here to shake your hand. You don't never shake my hand. God bless you. I'll shake somebody's hand and want to shake my hand. I'm God who saves people. Now I can preach. Don't talk to church folk too. Now, when I tell you to say this, if the person next to you don't say nothing, 9 out of 10 they church. And then I can go ahead back in the word. So the person next to you, I'm tired of church people. I'm not going to look around and turn my back on this one, but I don't want to see who didn't say nothing. I'm turning my back on this, but I don't want to see who didn't say nothing. So when I preach in your corner, you'll know I didn't see it. You know God is manifest and revealed in it. I can turn back around now. I didn't see nothing. So I preach in your direction. 9 out of 10. You just stepping on your little big toe. And you just got to say, "House Lord, help me do it right this time." All right, y'all sit down. Let's go. So now, here comes that dreamer again. He's dreaming all the time. But watch this. He's not really dreaming as we suppose. He's getting vision. He's getting vision. Even in dreaming, dream says there's something coming. Dreams can turn into visions, because dreams show you what's down the road. A
vision is an unveiled, revealed word given to you by God himself. Can I get somebody here? I brother Phil, I had a brother come to me last week, and he said, Pastor, at the job, he said, Pastor, I know you're a pastor, and I know that things are well with you because they talk well of you here at the school. I had a dream, and the dream was X, Y, and Z. What shall I do? I said, well, my brother, I must tell you this. I'm not an interpreter of dreams. But what I can tell you is no matter what the dream was, negative or positive, get closer to God. See, we try to go deep, trying to interpret a dream by what they tell you. If you're not an interpreter of dreams, you can't interpret a dream. But you can tell them, I don't care what it was, all it's saying to you, get closer to God. And they might, you know how sometimes you got a dream and you fall off the cliff. Huh? Y'all ain't dreaming no more. You know you had them bad dreams that you tossing and turning. Huh? You got to understand, some dreams are not God kind of dreams. Y'all ain't going to say nothing here. Y'all keep hearing, reading dreams and vision, you think God is still off. There's some dream that the devil is trying to put in your spirit and mess you up. When you start dreaming of that perfume and that cologne, that smell. Mm-hmm. All right. Y'all ain't want to walk down that road. I guess I better go back here. So now, here come, what we going to do with him? You understand, you can't do nothing with the anointing. You can't do, I don't care what you try to do. My Bible says, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. What shall we do with this dreamer? He comes again, and 9 out of 10, he has another dream, and we don't want to hear anything that he has to say. But they misunderstood what he had to say was going to save their life for the rest of their life. So they said, Reuben says, well, I got to find a way to save him. So let's put him in the pit. Watch what God does. Anytime the enemy comes at you, God has somebody that's standing by to grab your back. God got somebody watching what the enemy is saying about you. And then when they come and tell you, they're not telling you that you might tell the other person. They're telling you because when God brings up the past, you're going to say, I told you that God was going to deliver you. I told you God was going to make a way out of no way. I told you God was going to give you a miracle. Every time somebody tell me anything, Brother Phil, I say, I know God's going to do it. I don't care what I'm going through, I know God's going to do it. Because my hand is in God's hand. And I've got a strong grip on God. And God's got a strong grip on me. I understand that I can do nothing without him. I also understand with him, all things are not made possible. If I walk with God, God will walk with me. If I abide in him, he'll abide in me. And when I abide in him, I can ask what I will. And God said, Father, I'll give it to you because you're my servant. You're my man of God. If you call me, I'll answer. If you knock, I'll open my door. Here comes this dreamer. Here comes this visionary. God, I feel like preaching. Here comes this dreamer. Here comes this visionary. Here comes the one that's going to feed us when our land goes famine. They have no idea God is setting you up. The same person that you are disliking might be the person God sent by the pressure. The same person that you are paying no attention to. Disregard it. Put your nose on that. That might be the sent blessing to prepare you, talents ready. Call out what's happening first to somebody in this place. I'm almost done. God, I feel the Holy Ghost in here pushing me. God. And so now they say, well, let's put him in the pit. The pit is in the center. God, the pit is in the center of the wilderness. Watch this. And in the pit, there is no water. There is nothing that will cause him to survive because there is nothing in the pit that has manna, that has food, that has water. There's no prayer warriors in the pit. God, I feel something here. There's no choir singing in the pit. There's no preacher preaching a sermon in the pit. God, there's no missionary in the pit. There's no evangelist in the pit. There's no bishop in the pit. There's no prayer warriors in the pit that's going to lay hands on him. But I need you to understand God was in the pit waiting for him to get there. Because anytime God prepares you for anything, God will be right there for you. You don't have to
of seen God to know he's there. Matter of fact, the Bible says, no man has seen God at any time and live. And let's go deeper. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was called. The Word was made flesh.
Sent his word in the pit. I'm going to show you. I said, God sent his word in the pit. He didn't send no angel. The Bible didn't say no angel. But when Joseph was in the pit, God had sent his word that would sustain him until the Ishmaelites came by and picked him up to take him to the Egypt place, the place that was captivity, the same place that held them captive is going to be the place that he become king. Turn to your neighbor. Do not despise small beginnings. He that had begun a good work in you, the Bible said he will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. I may not look like I'm doing much now, but just keep hanging around me. After a while, I'm getting talents ready. He's preparing me for kingdom stuff. I might be in the pit today. Oh, God, but tonight around this time, God sent his word in the pit to bring me, to sustain me, and to hold me while I'm there. The Bible says, while he's in the pit, there's nothing there. Why do you not understand this? There is nothing there to sustain him. There is nothing there to keep him. There is no water there to drink. There's no food there to eat. There is nobody but the field praying for him. There's no crying. There's nobody singing how the Lord will make a way out of no way. There's nobody that's there that can help him. But when God has his hand on you, you don't need nobody but God. God will not come in a fleshly manner. God will come spirit or in word. If he does not see the angel, he'll come in word. He'll find a way to get you out. God, I wish I could preach here. I said, God will find a way to get you out. He said, I would never leave you, neither forsake you. I'll be with you until the end of the world. If you go in the pit, I'll get in the pit with you. If you get in the valley, I'll go in the valley with you. If you get sick, I'll be your doctor in the sick room. If you go to the courtroom, I'll be your judge. I'll be your lawyer. I'll be the one sitting in the Supreme Court and declare whom the Son has made free. The Bible said they are free indeed. I justified you. I don't care what they say. If I'm before you, I'm more than the whole world against you. So, jury is out. That Joseph had been tried and convicted by his brother. God, help me here. The enemy has tried you, and he believes he's convicted you, but he doesn't understand that Jesus said, I justified her, I justified him, and whom I justified, I glorified. You want to touch your neighbor quickly and tell them the justification of God brings glory to your name. God, that means that when I walk in the Holy Spirit, there must be glory. When I walk in the room, there must be some glory, because in the presence of the Lord, there is the fullness of joy, and at his right hand, the Bible said, there are pleasures forevermore. When you walk in the anointing, there is no demon, there is no devil in hell that can stop the plan or the move of God. God is preparing you, he's getting you polished ready. Somebody else shall prepare, polished ready. I'm not going to go through the storm, but he's preparing me for the polish. I'm polished ready. I've been down, but I'm up now. I'm polished ready. Never been paid 3 years old. Finds himself in a place he's never been before. An unfamiliar place. It's called the pit. Oh! But in a time, God is with you. The pit can be the palace. Oh, shut up. Y'all cannot miss that. Trouble can be the blessing. He said, I'll be a present help in trouble. Not in the time of trouble, in trouble. So every time trouble comes, I'm present. Y'all understand? Every time trouble comes upon a believer, he said, I'm present. Trouble here, God said, I'm here. Trouble, I'm here. Trouble, I'm here. I told him I'll be a present in trouble. Hallelujah. And so they put him in the pit. The Ishmaelites come by. They pick him up out of the pit. When they pick him up out of the pit, the brothers come back and they don't see him in there. Now they understand, blessed be God, that something has happened. So now they have got to lie. And every time you tell a lie, you got to tell another lie to cover up the first lie. I wish I had a witness in here that when you lie, and the Bible says a liar will not tarry in the eyesight of God. So what the brethren must understand is because of the grace and mercy of God, that God did not allow calamity to fall upon them, because the Bible says, touch not my anointed and do my prophets no harm. He was already a visionary that was in the pit. Wait a minute, Pastor Brown. Did you say a visionary was in the pit? Did you say a dreamer was in the pit? Shouldn't they be somewhere in the palace now? Because I've got to make sure you can handle pit before palace. I need to make sure you can handle trouble before joy. I need to understand you can handle hell before peace. I have somebody in here. I want to know, can you handle the demons that are chasing you? Do you understand? I'm a demon chaser. I need you know that you know I'm God.
In the pit, 17 years old, nothing there to help him. God got his word in there. The Ishmaelites come, they bring him out, the brothers go back, they don't see him. He says, let's take his coat back to our father. Blood on the coat from the animal that we killed. He will know that this is his coat. They weren't concerned if he would smell if that was his blood, because the different smell from an animal blood than human blood. I might help somebody in this place. But it's amazing that even though there's a difference between animal blood and human blood, he shed his blood that was our blood. Even though that's different from animal blood, it's not animal blood, versus the smell of human blood, he sent his son to shed his blood that washed our blood. And so I'm covered under the blood. I'm gonna get some palace ready for open here in a minute. And so they knew. Firstly, that the father would be more concerned, Brother Noel, about the coat, because he can identify the coat. I don't need to see the blood. That's his coat. I made that for him. I know. I care nothing about the blood. If that's his coat, that means that's him. The Bible said that his father sat in sackcloth and ashes, mourning, weeping. At the same time he's weeping, God is delivering his son. God, we've been laying door for a night, but joy is coming in the morning. Oh, help me just stay here. And so the Bible says that when the Ishmaelites come and get him, let me move quickly. They give him, they sell him for 20 pieces of silver to Potiphar, the captain guard of Pharaoh.
Yes. Well.
10 pieces of silver short than what Judas betrayed Jesus for. And when they did that, the Bible says that when Joseph goes to the house of Potiphar, he's well favored. His house is so blessed. I'm telling you, when the blessing comes, everything that connects to the blessing have got to become a part of the blessing. When he gets in Potiphar's house, the Bible said he was so well favored and he was so prosperous that everything he put his hand on caused Potiphar's house to be blessed. I come to tell somebody that everything you touch this season, it's going to become your blessing. Every place that you put your feet upon, it's going to become your blessing. And you stretch out the hand toward it, it's going to be your blessing. It's going to bring you something spiritual return that is going to blow your mind. You're going to be able to lay hands on things and blessings are going to pour out of dirty stuff. Y'all miss what God said to you. I said, you're going to lay hands on things and God's going to cleanse what you lay your hands on, and he's going to purify it, and God's going to call a spiritual return to start happening in your life. God is about to send a release your way, because he's showing you that you are ready for college. You're prepared.
compelling, and you let the man of palace or lifestyle, you need to let everybody around you know that I'm getting prepared for palace or lifestyle. I'm not giving beneath my purpose, not another day.
Tell everybody around you,
I'm palace ready. Tell somebody else, I'm palace ready. I'm palace ready. I'm palace ready. I belong in the kingdom. I belong with God. I'm palace ready. I'm palace ready. After all I've been through,
the devil is alive. So, they bring him out. He's in the house, he's a powerhouse, and all the blessings, somebody shout all the blessings. And all the blessings, watch this, are falling in Potiphar's house. Because Joseph is in Potiphar's house. Had not Joseph got there, the blessings would not be there. But the moment he walked in the door, the Bible says Potiphar found favor with him, said he's well favored and he's prosperous, and the blessings of the Lord are upon him, and all that I have in my house is blessed because he's here. Read the Bible for yourself. All that I have in my house is blessed because Joseph is living here. I've got news for somebody. You ought to be glad you're living with me, because you're living with a blessing. Oh God, I wish I could preach to somebody in this place. We might not have the house on the hill. We might not have a free bedroom, but God knows if you live in my house, you're living with a blessing. And every time I call the name of Jesus, something will return in my house. Demons got to get out. Healing's got to happen. Miracles will be wrought. My children will be saved. I thought somebody shouted in my house. After me in my house, we're going to serve the Lord. So, the Bible says that now all the blessings are there. Everything that's happening in Potiphar's house is happening because Joseph is there. But you got to understand that some people around you are only blessed because they're around you. God, they got the blessing right in their midst. The blessing is next door to them. The blessing is across the street from them. The blessing sitting next to them at job. You got to understand, some people in this place, the only blessing you have is because you're standing next to the blessing. And because God decided to bless him, he'll bless you. If you are standing there, you might not be here long. Everything in Potiphar's house is blessed and interest. Everything. He said, everything I have is blessed. Because Joseph is here. Anytime you get ready for next level living, or you're prepared for palace living, the enemy gets busy. And so now, Potiphar's wife, she pays close attention to Joseph. She's not looking at the anointing, she's looking at the man. Y'all need to hear me here. That's why you got me. The Bible said he did find it. So women stop looking. The Bible said he did find it. Women stop looking. The Bible said he did find it. Women, please stop looking. The Bible said he did find it. Women, please stop looking. The Bible said he did find it. Because you might find a man, but not an anointed man. Women, please stop looking. The Bible said he did find it. He did find it. And he cannot find you in the club. He cannot find you in the bar. He cannot find you. Not the man of God. Because the man of God is going to be in the house of God. He's going to find you in the house of God. Please help me here. Some of y'all have found men in places that's not like God, and that's why it is a shipwreck now. Because when God put his anointing on a man of God, he stands there through the storm, he stands there through the rain, because he understands that I am positioned to be in position. Oh. Oh. He understands that now Potiphar's wife is checking out Joseph. She's not looking at the anointing. You know, y'all women know how you check a brother out. You know. Y'all know y'all giving up. Talk to me, Diamond. You know how you're giving up and down. Look, it's got to be a certain way. It's got to be a certain way. Well, here's something. Watch this. Something's gonna be. This is gonna be rich. Never believe that you're gonna choose a man based on what you expect. My life, my whole life, has been red bones. Ain't nothing red about that girl up front. Never chocolate bar. That's it. How did I continue to look red bones?
I might have got a red one, but not a woman of God. I might have got a red one, but not a good woman, a good mother, a good sister, a good lady, a good lady. See, because the enemy want to twist it on you. And you know, everybody got this thing, Sister Collins, Charles, Dark, and Harrison. Sure, ain't too many tall, dark, handsome brothers out in here. Not tall, maybe dark. You better look for the anointing. You better make sure it's anointing when it comes to your house. Because everything that glitters is not gold. I don't care what nobody tell you. So she is looking at Joseph, Mother Smith, and she's looking at him with bad intentions. Here's what the Bible says, not Brown. The Bible says, she says, come and lay with me. This Bible is in there. Read it. Pick it up. Come and lay with me. Here's what, why Joseph responds. Because he's a visionary that came from a pit. That has God on his side. He says, your husband, my master, have given me everything except you, because you're his wife, and I dare not touch you. He left the house, came back the next day, the Bible says. When he came back the next day, all of the men that worked in the house were gone. Isn't it crazy that the enemy would try to set you up? Children gone. And all of a sudden you get that knock on the door. It's him. Or you get that phone call. Hey, Colonel, what happened?
Oh, what was he doing? What? Hey, girl, what the hell am I thinking about you? You've been running through my brain all night long. Don't talk to me. Tell me what's happening. I've been dreaming about you, girl. When God made you, he made you for me. I don't know what you've been doing, but I've been checking you out. You can start preaching. We go home and forget the mind of heat. Hey!
So now, but she is conniving. She's conniving because she waits till nobody's dead. And she says to him, come lay with me. He said, I'm not going to do it. She grabs him by the coat. And because he would not stay, you got to understand, I don't care how close the enemy gets, you better run when you know the enemy's there. As a matter of fact, no, don't run. The Bible says, resist him and he'll flee. The enemy will start running from you. You don't have to run. Stand there and give me word. Stand there and give me power. The devil will lie. You're not going to bother me. I'm going to wait until I get married. The devil will lie. You can't touch this.
I've been reserved for God, man. I'm not playing this sinful game with you. I can't lose my anointing behind you. I'm going to stand on God's word. You can tell me how cute I am, and I'm a 24-36, whatever that is, all you want. But I'm out my way for God. My body belongs to the Lord. That's when you know that you're being callous. Where you can stand against people that come against you that can press you. When the same thing that used to get you no longer gets you. And you can look them in the face and say, I'm sorry. Love don't get in the car. Joseph goes, she grabs his coat, Joseph comes. She summons the men that were close by. And she's that Hebrew that y'all brought here, that y'all gave favor to. He tried me. I've got proof right here. The enemy will try to get proof on you. Yeah. But what he doesn't understand about you, you can get all the proof you want. The evidence will be when God bring me out. When God manifests the thing that he said he was going to do in my life. Have you ever been lied on and God brought you through that lie? Have they ever lied on you and God held your hand through the lie? And you said, I'm not going nowhere because it's a lie. And God will hold you up. God will carry you through the lie. And deception. So the men quickly went and they got Potiphar. And they said, the Hebrew you brought in, he tried to sleep with your wife. Here is the proof. The same kind of proof that the brother sent back home to the father. And the same kind of proof that Potiphar's wife had in her hand. They thought they had evidence, but what they had was somebody that was anointed by God. They thought they had evidence, but what they had was a manifestation of what God was going to do. Y'all ain't going to hear me too. They thought, Brother Pope, that they had evidence. The only evidence they had was that God is walking with him. The only evidence they had is that God had his hand on him. The only evidence they had was that God was with him. And the Bible says, that Potiphar says, put him in prison. Now you got to understand, this is going to be deep, Brother Demetrius, that they put him in prison for doing absolutely nothing but serving God and holding on to integrity and keeping his character and holding his place and being mindful of the word that was spoken over his life. He stayed there. I'm not bowing. I'm not bending. I'm not going to do nothing but stay right here. Anytime you're being palace prepared, you got to have a Queen Esther mentality. If I perish, let me perish, but I'm going to see the king. Who knows that I was sent to the kingdom for such a time? That's this. You got to have a Ruth mentality. I'm not going nowhere. Your God gonna be my God. Your people gonna be my people. You get me prepared for the palace, Naomi. I watch how God dealt with you. I'm not going nowhere. I know my husband dead, and I know you don't have no more son, but I'm not going nowhere. As a matter of fact, Naomi told Ruth, go to another country where there are single men. She says, no, I've seen the favor on your hand. I've seen God with you. I'm not going nowhere. I'll stay here. And the Bible says she is back in the field pleading. Women of God, you got to understand. Stop trying to be noticed and just be a lady. Ruth was not trying to be seen. Ruth got in the back of the field. And she's bleeding in the back. Boaz come from where he's at, never seen her before. And immediately takes notice of her. And he said, who is this? He said, that's Ruth from the back. She's here, bleeding in the field. He said, the next time she won't water, call her over here and give her order from this place. I don't care where you are. God will find a way to bless you. Call her. I said, God will find a way to bless you. When God got his hand on you, she gets her Boaz. Pause for a few moments, and then I get into something. We have too many women looking for a Boaz. All right. But they're not a Ruth. Look for Boaz, but you're not a Ruth. Only a Ruth get a Boaz. Yeah. All right, back to it. All right, so now he's in prison. And while he's in prison, the keeper of the prison found favor with him. Watch this. He went to prison, but the keeper of the prison found favor with him, and he became the keeper of the prison. Wait a minute. Where you sent me, I'm now the man. I'm watching the prisoners who I was. Your enemy meant for your bad. God will turn that thing around for your good. I don't care what nobody tell you how spiritual they are. What the enemy of your bad does, I'll turn it around for your good. What he meant for your evil. What he tried to do to you, I'll turn that thing around for your good. Now he's watching the prisoners. And the Bible says that over there in the kingdom of Egypt is Pharaoh. Pharaoh has a butler and a baker. that offended him, he put him in the same prison that Joseph was in. You got to understand something. God will send your blessing to you. Y'all just missed it. I said, God will send your blessing to you. Watch how the blessing falls. So the baker is there and the butler is there in the same prison that Joseph is in. And they have dreams. The butler has the first dream. And the butler's looking for somebody to interpret the dream. And they said, we have a Hebrew in here that knows God, that he talks about God, so I'm quite sure he can interpret. Joseph goes to the butler and he says, I had a dream, blessed be God, that there were three vine branches hanging upon me, and out of the branches there came grapes, and I was holding the cup of king of Egypt, Pharaoh, and I poured the grapes into the cup. What do you mean that dream is? Joseph said, in 3 days, you're going to be restored back to being the cupbearer for the king. And so now the baker sees this and he hears this and he feels like, wow, something good is about to happen. And the baker goes and says, well, Joseph, wait a minute. I have a dream. He said, what was your dream? He said that there was three baskets upon my head. Inside the basket were baked meats, food. And the birds came and ate them out of the basket. What does that mean? He said, in 3 days, Pharaoh's going to have your head, hang you on a tree, and the birds are going to come and eat your flesh. Y'all ain't talking back in here. And so now you're trying to figure, where the blessing, where the blessing, where the blessing. And so the Bible says that 2 years later, watch this, 2 years later, that they are in Pharaoh's palace. Pharaoh now has a dream. Watch this. Here's what's amazing. Joseph dreams, the butler dreams, the baker dreams, not the king of Egypt is dreaming. Everybody dreaming about the dreamer. Gosh, I wish I could get somebody here. God will put your enemy on your mind. And he keep bothering you and keep trying to mess with you. God will make your enemy lose sleep messing with you. Oh, God, help me here. Everybody's dreaming about the dreamer. And the dreamer that dreamed the first dream is the interpreter of all the dreams. When God prepare you, palace ready, he'll give you a dream. He'll give you a vision that will allow you to see what is about to happen. And so now Pharaoh has a dream. And he says, I am looking for somebody that can interpret my dream. Nobody could interpret the dream. All the musicians that he tried to find, he couldn't find nobody. Shroud of the source, nobody. And guess what happens? Before the butler leaves prison, Joseph tells him, when you get to place, remember me. He gets there and he said, wait a minute, Pharaoh. I know somebody. But he's in prison. His name is Joseph. He interpreted my dream. He told me I was going to be restored. Bible says that Pharaoh said, go get him, shave him up, clean him up, and bring him here. They brought Joseph to Pharaoh. Pharaoh says, listen, I had a dream that there were seven cows. And there were seven good cows. And then there were seven thin cows. The thin cows came and ate up the seven fleshy cows, the good cows, the fatted cows. And then I had a dream about 7 ears of corn. Some were good corn, some was wasted corn. And when I came to the place, I want to understand what that means. He said, that means you're going to have 7 years of famine, but you have 7 good years. He said, so now I need somebody to help me when the 7 years of famine come that can help me during the famine. They're still looking for somebody, and the dreamer is right up under their nose. Sometimes the blessing is right in your face, and you don't even know the blessing is there because you're trying to find the blessing somewhere else, and God put the blessing right in front of you. Look at your neighbor and say, you might be my blessing. And because you don't want to acknowledge the fact that they might be your blessing, they can't be your blessing. He says, you know what, Joseph? I've seen God's hand on you. I am going to restore you out of prison. I'm going to make you king of Egypt if you can help me out. Joseph told him, when the 7 years of goodness come to the land, I'll get enough, watch the wisdom, to hold that when the 7 years of famine come, we won't be in famine. God will give you wisdom. I will come in and I will take all that we have, knowing that the first 7 years are going to be good years, but the next seven gonna be famine. I will get enough to store up for us that when the 7 years of famine come, we won't be in famine.
Amen.
You're the man. At 30 years old, 13 years later from 17, he becomes king of Egypt. Everything he said, he did, he accomplished. He comes from pit to prison to palace. Everything in the pit made him palace ready. Everything in the prison made him palace ready. So when he got to the palace, he wasn't arrogant. He was humble enough to know that it was God that had his hand on him the entire time. When God elevates you, when God moves you to the next level, it's not arrogant, it's like humility. He moves there, and the Bible says, now the famine hits. After the good years of seven, the famine hits. Watch this. When the famine hits, his father and his brethren are in the land, but there is nothing happening. His father said that there's food in Egypt. He said, sons, he said, go to Egypt and buy food and drink so that we don't die. The same dreamer that you put in the pit is now king. The same dreamer that said, you all will pay obedience unto me. This is King of Egypt. The same dreamer that said, God showed me something. It's now at the palace. They have no idea. They come. He sees them. He knows that it's them, but they don't know it's them because it's 13 years later. They don't know it's him. But the same one you thought destroyed is the one that's getting ready to beat you and take care of you. When you are palace prepared, God will take you through a pit and he'll put you in prison. But he's preparing you for the palace. He just wants to know, can you handle the pit, man? Can you handle the prison? Can you handle nobody being around you? Can you handle being by yourself? And know that I still got your back. Can you handle people misusing you that said they love you? People that's got your own blood despising you, hating you, the Bible says, and want to destroy you. Be careful of the hand that you bite. But sometimes that's the same hand that's going to feed you. His brother had come, they don't know him. At some point, the Bible says about seven chapters later that he reveals himself to his brother. And he says to his brother, go get our father. The Bible says he's crying, he's weeping. Now they know who he is. Now they go get the father when the father comes. There is a mourning going on. Remember verse 11 of the 37th chapter? That the father observed the same. He paid close attention because he knew something was going to happen. God brought Joseph, 17 years old, allowed him to go to bed, put him in prison. Now he's in the palace at 30 years old, 13 years later. Could it be, ladies and gentlemen, that you're trying to push the level that God is holding you at? Could it be you're trying to go before he said go? Could it be you're trying to do what he has not yet said to? 13 years. Are you willing to wait on him? Are you willing to trust him in your pit state? Are you willing to trust him in your prison condition? But I want you to hear this clearly. He has prepared you. Palace ready. Stand up, Clay. He's getting you palace ready. There's some stuff you have to endure. And there's some stuff you're still enduring. But it could be that he's getting you palace ready. Could it be that I couldn't stand it? It's not going to be easy for me. I'm going to have some storms, some roadblocks. I'm going to have some pit days. Some prison days.
our palace. Let's get the kingdom ready. When Jesus goes to that cross, he is being palace prepared. He has to go through the city. He's got to carry the cross. They've got to ridicule him, spit on him. And when he gets to the cross, they put thorns on his head, nails in his feet, nails in his hand, piercing in his side.
Hallelujah.
They had no idea he was preparing for the kingdom. The Bible says, if it had not been for the shedding of his blood, there would be no remission of sin. Had he not laid his life down and nobody took him, there would be no you and I. Talisman and kingdom. I've got to go to my Father. But I will not leave you comfortless. I'm telling you. All of the things you had to endure thus far, making the palace ready, kingdom ready. You've got to understand there's a cost for kingdom. It's not easy, it's a cost. Sacrifice. It takes a sold out individual to walk in kingdom. But when he knows that he can then trust you, he'll take you to the kingdom. He'll give you palace stuff. Blessings beyond and exceeding abundantly above all you can ask or think according to the power that lives within us. He'll open up doors. He'll make ways out of no way for you. Healings will come. Miracles will be brought. Faith will be given up to you. He is getting the knowledge ready. That's why you have to endure the stuff you have to endure. He's getting the knowledge ready. You didn't go for it for nothing. You're not going for it for nothing. Joseph didn't now know all that he had, 17-30, and still stand on his feet. Some of you haven't went through nothing for 13 years. You just got 2 years in the kingdom, and you complaining already. Made a vision of blood 12 years before she got healed. 12 years before she got healed. God's preparing you. He's getting you ready for palace living, kingdom living. Grab somebody's hand and you're standing next to him. He's getting you ready. 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 Why am I going through this? He's getting me ready. Why do I have to face this? He's getting me ready. Why am I going through this at this time of my life? At this time of my life, I should be through this by now. He's getting me ready. Why be God? I'm getting you ready. Everybody in my family seems to be doing good except me. He's getting me ready. They don't like me. I'm the baby. He's getting you ready. And what I love about Joseph, Joseph paid no attention to what his brothers said. Sometimes you got to pay no attention. And sometimes it's family members. That's what it was, your family. Like, I can't pay y'all no attention. I've got a job to do. I've got a family. I've got stuff I got to do. I love y'all, but y'all got to talk back to me. I love y'all, but this is what I got to do. I got to do a script. This is what God told me to do. My mother and my mother-in-law said to me in First Nation, whatever y'all have in problems, do not come to us. But my mama, do not come. You know why? Because at the end of the day, you got to go back home. And because we ain't gonna take no sides. They'll work it out. Man, work it out. Just like y'all stood before the altar and said, I do, get back in the house and say, I do again. And my wife will tell you they've never gotten anything we've ever had in our life. Sometime, your family can be your worst enemy. Matter of fact, before I pray, let me tell you this real deal. My sisters didn't even like my wife. But they didn't know her. How in the world, after 3 or 4 months, y'all talking about marriage? We don't even know her. She sits upstairs in the dark. She don't talk to nobody. I know I have to tell them that. They don't know. She was praying in the dark. That's what was happening. She was praying. They said, she's sitting in the dark all the time. How you gonna marry her? She don't come downstairs. She don't talk to us. We gonna try to talk to her. She's sitting on the bed like an Indian in the Indian style, watching TV. So guess what? They told me because they didn't know my wife, they didn't like it because they didn't know her. They told me, if y'all get married, we ain't coming. And what I told them, guess what? Y'all ain't coming. Amen. 'Cause I'm married to that woman.
Amen.
I ain't marrying y'all. When y'all get married, y'all ain't gonna let me get in y'all business. So, if y'all don't come, y'all don't come. We get married. This is the day we get married. Now they love her to death. No, they love her to life. Ain't no death though. They love her to life. They love her to death. Now get that out of my mouth. They love her tonight. Because now they know her. Joseph has some brother in Haiti. Y'all got people in y'all family who don't like y'all because y'all prospering. Because y'all doing better than what they're doing. I hear your blood is thicker than water. But when blood starts to messing you up, as you got that hand, you might be the Joseph of this century. Hallelujah. Visionary with a dream. You might be a visionary with a dream. And God's going to do some great things in your life. Hallelujah. Listen to me. God is getting the palace ready. I don't care what you're going through. He's getting you ready for the kingdom. Your anointing is going to be heavy this year. The level that you're going to walk in, undeniable, inevitable, is going to happen. Because God said it. Every head bowed. Father, we approach your throne. Grace and mercy. But first of all, say thank you for your word. Your word says to me that it will go out and it will accomplish everything you sent it for to do. It did that. So that I say thank you. Thank you for the lives that were changed today. And whatever way they were changed, it's called change. Thank you for the minds that are now thinking this thing over again. They're processing. How do I get closer to God that I can become that Joseph or that Ruth or that Esther? Their focus is changing. Maybe it's me, God. It may not be her, it might be me. It may not be him, it might be me. So God, help me to examine myself. Because I know beyond a shadow of a doubt, I'm being prepared for palace living. And I'm ready to live and have life more abundantly. I'm living beneath my privilege. I want to live so that you're pleased with me. So God, I pray that your hand will cover your people. As under the sound of my voice, everything they need, God supply it. Wherever they come short, be with them to bring them up. Whatever's trying to frustrate them, help them to know that's my pit, that's my prison, but my palace is waiting for me. So God, now, as we prepare to leave this place never in your presence, be with us every step of the way. As we have great fellowship today, one with another, with our family, with our friends, remind us that all things work together for the good of them who love you and them who are called according to your purpose. Joseph was called, and the purpose was manifested that he would be king at 30 years old and provide for the family that did not want him to be around him. Thank you for the circle of people you've put in our lives. Positive people, people that are growing, people that are going somewhere, people that are kingdom minded. That's the circle that I want to be in. God, I thank you for every blessing, every door open, every door closed, every miracle you wrought. Today is the beginning of a new day, of the best days of the rest of our lives. It's happening now. In Jesus' name, we say thank you, thank you, thank you. Loose that hand and give God a great big hand. We at this time want to open the doors of the church quickly, so we have our communion coming. That's the last thing we do. If you're here visiting with us and you don't have a home church, everybody needs a home church. And if you don't have a home church, and the Spirit of the Lord has oppressed upon you.